Thanks for staying up later. Jerry Van Dyke is with us tonight, and as we tape, word has just come in that this past week, before the taping, Coach was number 3 overall in the ratings. That's good news, but especially good news for you. We might as well start here, because I am told that maybe more than any man in television, you are obsessed with ratings.
Yeah, I don't know who you've been talking to, but it is true. And I guess I'm criticized for it a lot, but if anybody's had my career, would be obsessed with that. They say, why do you watch the ratings? Because I want to know when I go to work that I'm going to still have a job. I have had shows where I was out of a job and didn't know it because I wasn't paying attention. And you either get the numbers or you're not on the air. And especially a few years back, it is still the same way. But so I just keep an eye on what's happening with my career, my job. I want to know I have a job, or if I'm not going to have a job, I'll get another one, I'll know. But I've gone to work and actually had, you know, the old story of my dressing room is no longer there.
But now, before we bring it back to Coach for the happy ending, let's recount this list of unfortunate developments. You're in Sheldon Leonard's Only Failure,
yeah.
Accidental Family.
Right.
It's one of the legendary producers of television.
Of all time.
Hit after hit,
right.
Classic after classic.
Right.
This one goes down the drain.
Right.
Andy Griffith in his Only Failure.
Down the drain.
And you are in and forever associated with the immortal My Mother the Car.
Right, right.
This would dent the confidence of the best of men.
Yeah, well, just what you said would dent the confidence, and that isn't all. there's much more. You know, there's Judy Garland. I was the sidekick with Judy Garland, too, on her infamous hour variety show. And you know, there's a few other bombs in there. I'm hard-pressed to remember it. 13 Queens Boulevard lasted 7 shows. Yeah, so, you know, it could dent your confidence.
And did it? Did you believe after a while, hey, it's one thing to have some bad breaks, but maybe I'm just not any good?
Yeah. You know, it never entered my mind. Ignorance is bliss. I always thought I was really funny. It just wasn't my medium, I guess. I didn't get through. I knew then. It's a crapshoot. The whole thing is a crapshoot. You either get the right people and or you don't. It clicks or it doesn't click. There wasn't one, let me say this, there wasn't one show that I did that I thought would be successful. Now ask me, you're going to ask me, then why did I do them?
Going in?
Yeah.
Going in, you didn't think these shows would be successful?
No. The only one that I thought had a good chance was My Mother the Car, only because gimmick shows were very popular at the time. And they were,
You mean like Mr. Ed or something?
Mr. Ed, I Dream of Jeannie, Bewitched, My Favorite Martian. Those kind of shows were working and were very successful. It was a kiddie show, and I figured it could be very successful. And plus, it wasn't a pilot. They offered it to me. It wasn't a pilot. They said, this is going on the air, and we want you to do it. Grant Taker, who I played tennis with. And, you know, it's a job. I make a living out of this business. People say, why did you do these things? And not realizing, it's like my father said, why are you doing that show? Why don't you do the Red Skelton show? My dad thought I had a choice, you know, when I picked My Mother the Car. Which isn't the way it works, you know. You get to get on the air and anything. I wanted a job. I had a family. I was raising a family. This is how I make my living. I make my living in this, and you just don't get your pick. You're lucky to get on a series of any kind. And I thought My Mother the Car might make it. Thank God it didn't, because I don't think I could have gone through. I turned down Gilligan's Island before My Mother the Car because it was a bad script.
Well, wait a minute. When you're working from the standard of My Mother the Car, pretty much everything looks bad in comparison.
Well,
so you really
true.
Have a warped perspective.
Well,
if you're
going
to demand that everything adhere to that standard, you're never going to be satisfied.
A 1928 Porsche, that's my mother dear. She helps me through everything I do, and I'm so glad she's here.
My Mother the Car is sort of like the generic definition of a bad sitcom. A, because it was a bad show, and B, because it has such a goofy title that it works well in a joke.
Exactly. You know, one year, this is really the 1 year, My Mother the Car was voted the worst show on television, and the Dick Van Dyke Show was the best. Yeah. You live
with
that for a while.
Creates a good dynamic at Thanksgiving dinner, doesn't it?
Yeah, it really does. It really does. At least with nowhere to go but up. And I keep throwing it to my brother. He recommended I take my mother to the car, by the way, which he denies to this day, but it is the truth.
He is now taken to calling himself, at this stage of his life, Jerry Van Dyke's brother.
Yeah, well, I just read TV Guide the other day, and it said, you know, what I like to watch, Dick Van Dyke, and it said, Jerry's older brother. I loved it. I loved it. Because he told me that, he said, you know, this really isn't that bad. He wanted me to stop bugging him, is what it was. See, I was bugging him to do something. You know, I did four Van Dyke shows, and I was under, but I was trying to get Carl Reiner to write a spinoff or something.
So he's just trying to find you a gig so his phone stops ringing.
Take anything. You know, that's what it was. I know that's what it was. I didn't think My Mother the Car was that great. I didn't think it was good, but it was, you know, it was going on the air. And due respect to myself, they told me that the car wasn't going to do. Every situation comedy has a guy, you got to get a guy in trouble, and this comedy is getting him out of trouble. Well, I had a problem. I had a car that talked. It was my mother. Nobody else knew.
She was a 1928 Porter, no less.
That's my mother, dear. She helps me through everything I do, and I'm so glad she's here. My mother, they had to stop, cut off the backfiring. They had it and didn't realize what was happening. Then one day, the network, just before it goes on the air, said, wait a minute. You can't do that. A car wouldn't say that. We said that a lot, too.
A car wouldn't. What's the car's motivation?
Yeah, they did say it.
That's not true to character.
Well, we did a lot of that. We did a lot of these kind of discussions. It was one camera with no audience. I'll tell you, I was mighty happy when that show ended. We did one season was 39 shows back then. 39 shows one season, which lasted more than, you know, two other series I did.
So the premise was that she was reincarnated. She had died, she's reincarnated
as
the car. She speaks to you, she gives you advice, she gives you inspiration.
Right.
Allow me to refresh your memory, which I really think doesn't need much refreshing, because much as you may have tried to suppress it, it seems like it's all too clear to you. But here are a couple of plot summaries. Mother gets amnesia from a bump on the bumper. The only way to cure her is to give her an even harder bump. Show two, Dave gets his mother a TV for the garage, Dave would be you, where she wins 5,000 gallons of gas on a quiz show, but must appear in person to collect it.
You know, I swear, I don't remember those premises. I do remember her getting antifreeze and getting drunk on one episode.
Something's wrong with your steering mechanism.
If you're going to get personal, I'll get out of the walk. You heard me. Just don't blame me for your dad driving. Thank you, Brad, driving.
What's the matter with you, anyway?
Nothing wrong with me. I feel wonderful.
You sound like you're tipsy. Antifreeze. The alcohol in the antifreeze. Mom, you are tipsy. You're soused.
At another stage of your career, you had a shot at some regular appearances on the Ed Sullivan Show.
Mm-hmm.
And that got derailed too, right?
Yeah. I had done two Ed Sullivan shows in the service by winning a worldwide contest when they had the, you know, they used to have all the services, the all Army, all Navy. And then when I got out of the service, this is way before the Dick Van Dyke Show and everything, I went in and I got an Ed Sullivan show, and I went in the afternoon. They used to do an afternoon show, and then they do with an audience, but they didn't tape it. And then they do a nighttime show.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just a dress rehearsal, so to speak. And I did the afternoon show and killed them. They loved me. And called my manager. I had a guy from Atlanta that started my brother also. Monk Arnold is his name. And they called him up and made a deal for eight shows, the verbal deal for eight more shows. And we went out and celebrated and had a few drinks, and I went back and bombed bad that night on the air, and I never did another Sullivan show. That was that story.
So now you think about all these things before Coach. There's a lot of things that could really cause somebody to just throw in the towel. Did you come close? Or did you actually throw it in and have to pull it back a few times?
I never thought of throwing in the towel because I didn't have anything to fall back on. I always wanted to be in the business, and I don't think anybody goes into this business thinking they're going to make it or be successful or make a living out of it. I was happy to be making a living out of the business, and I enjoyed doing what I was doing. And I wanted to be a comic since I was 8 years old, and therefore didn't study or do my work in school because I was going to be in show business. I was going to be a comic. I used to sit and write routines and do things in class and had a, you know, my education suffered. So I had nothing to fall back on. The mere thought of doing something else, I didn't even have thought of.
When you're smiling, when you're smiling, the whole world, it smiles with you. When you're laughing, oh babe, when you're laughing, the sun was a come shining through. But when you're crying, you bring on the rain. So stop that sighing. Come on and be happy again. Keep on smiling. Cause when you're smiling, baby, the whole world smiles with you.
How much did being Dick Van Dyke's brother figure in this? Was it a case of, I got to do something, I got to put something on the scoreboard that counts here in light of what my brother has done, or was that just incidental?
You mean as far as...
As far as a motivation. Would the motivation have been the same just because of a desire to be in show business and it's all you knew, or was the brother part of the motivation too?
I wanted to be in show business almost before he did. He's 6 years older than I am, but he did plays, and so he was more or less a drama. I wanted to be a comedian, and I did. I was the class clown and everything. No, there wasn't. We were in two different businesses. I did an act. I wanted to be a live performer, a comic, and he was an actor. And to me, this wasn't. We were in two different businesses altogether. His success, I saw it as a way to get in. You know, I didn't say, damn, my brother made it. I said, wow, this is a chance. Still to this day, he was so glad I got a hit series, because I called him, bugging him all the time. I wanted to be, you know, you got any work? Give me something. Come on. And, it never came to pass. I was very happy to hang on his coattails to make a living and to be in the business. You know, I wasn't in competitive with him at all. I was happy for his success. Then when he put me on the show, see, being his Dick Van Dyke's brother was, you know, not good going through, you know, being somebody's brother. Everybody wants to be their own self. On the other hand, perhaps I would have never gotten to where I was without being on his show. And after all, I still have reviews at home where I came off fantastic on his show. You know, that is still the best thing to this day I've ever done.
Well, you know, Rob, I've always liked comedy. And I've been thinking, well, that maybe I'd like to be a comedian.
A comedian?
Yeah, around the barracks, I cut up.
The premise was funny. You were a guy, you were his brother, what was his first, Stacy?
Stacy, right.
Stacy Petrie?
Yeah, right.
And he wasn't that funny when he was awake, but when he was asleep, I guess his inhibitions went away and he'd sleepwalk and he'd be very funny.
Right, right. They were excellent. That's excellent. So it's the best thing I've ever done up until Coach. I mean, ever. In 30 years, I did crap, you know, and this is the first time. I mean, I knew I had ability, but the material, I mean, I just got caught in, you know, there's not a lot of... The premise of that show, what made the Dick Van Dyke so great outside of the great talent in the show and the writing, was that every episode was something that happened to one of them or somebody they knew. And that's how I got into the picture. My brother would tell, they would sit around and talk and tell stories like this about what happened to them and when they were kids and everything. Yeah. And Dick used to talk about me being a sleepwalker, which I was. And Carl said, gee, that's a funny idea for a show, and wrote the show.
The fellow that crossed a parrot with a tiger, the man said, what'd you get? He says, I don't know, but when he talks, you better listen. Or the fellow walks in the psychiatrist's office, and he's all orange and blue and purple and green all over, and he's got a pelican on his head, and the pelican has a fish in his mouth. And they walk up to the psychiatrist, and the pelican says, say, can you tell me how to get this guy out from under my feet?
Is it better for your relationship with him that Coach has been so successful? Was there some unspoken thing between the two of you prior to this that was a little awkward, loving one another as brothers, but he had had his critical and commercial successes, and you were still looking for that in a big way? You'd had it in pockets, but still looking for it in a big way. Does that help?
Help our relationship.
Yeah, help get past that awkwardness?
Well, it wasn't an awkwardness on my part. Now, I think maybe Dick was saying, gee, I wish Jerry could do better. I'd like to see Jerry, or, you know. To me, I was very happy with his success. He's 6 years older than I am. I think that had a lot to do with it. He was in high school and out of high school before I got in. He was a good-looking guy, wore suits to school. I was the idiot, the class clown. I mean, I was just, you know, didn't do well in school. It was almost not the same as a father, but I was proud of him. But I didn't want to do because, see, when my day, I was in sports. I played all the sports, and he was in the plays. And my day, back then, he was a sissy. And all the other guys' brothers were on the football team. And Dick was in the plays. Well, I had a lot of fights over that. So I didn't necessarily...
Standing up for him.
Standing up for him, yeah. Standing up for him. And, you know, I couldn't... but, you know, then later on, I got him back. But I was a little embarrassed going to the plays. You know, I went to the plays and sit through the dramas, you know, in high school. You know, and it was very boring, the Philadelphia Story. And I'm sitting there watching him in plays. Had he been doing more comedy, it might have been different. But I always admired and looked up to Dick, and he's a great talent, and I never had a sibling rivalry with him. Now, he didn't have a rivalry with me. I think he'd like to see me do better, and is very happy for my success, too.
So now we have some of the background, and that brings us to Coach. But early on, I'm told, that almost went down the drain. There was some sort of fight between you and Craig Nelson that might have imperiled your role in the show?
Well, it could have. Having a fight with a star, you know, is not, you know, isn't the secret to success. yeah, it was actually the fight, which we still have periodically, was great early on because of what it showed, that we're two of the same kind of people, and made us very close. We got into a screaming fight. I don't know, it was the first season, the first 13 shows, and I don't know what it was about. And we got a scream, and I told him to go to hell, and we screaming at each other, and I left, walked off the stage, went to my dressing room saying, well, you know, I've been through this before. I'm out of work again, and I'm shaking, just shaking all over. You know, it's just terrible. Then I started kicking myself. You idiot! You gotta, you know, you blew it again. And I'm there, just shaking, not knowing what to do. Should I go back? Should I go? And they come and knock on my door, and open the door, and it was Craig. And he looked at me for a minute, and all of a sudden we both broke up laughing so hard we couldn't even talk. We just died laughing. We couldn't talk. We laughed for about 10 minutes. We just all of a sudden saw the kind of people we were. We're both very, very, our backgrounds are so close and very similar. We get mad and scream, and we're over it. And we blow off steam like this. And a lot of people don't do that. They hold back, and which is probably the best thing to do, but we can't do it. When we scream, we scream. When we fight, and we mean it at the time, and we want to kill each other. And then we're the best of friends, and it's over, and that's that. That's the way we operate, but we didn't know that at the time.
I don't want to end up like you, a whip furniture-loving girl boy. Will you stop saying that? I've watched it happen, Hayden, over the last 5 years, little by little, piece by piece. Then giant chunks started falling off. I mean, you lost your man things.
I haven't lost anything at all, Luther. I have grown.
Yeah, you've grown to a lovely young woman.
We love each other, but then we fight, too. And, you know, it's not maybe the best of relationships, but it's the way we operate.
So now, with 3 Emmy nominations and a perpetual place in the top 10, you still can't completely shake that that feeling of, hey, any day could be the last, because, as we said at the beginning, the morning after each week's show, you're on the phone to the executives, you want the overnights, and then the next day or a few hours later, whenever it is, you want the national ratings.
Exactly.
You're on top of them as if you're a guy with the Hollywood Reporter or something.
Exactly,
right?
Exactly. You know, it's almost something I can't stop. I can't stop myself. We have a two-year pickup now. I mean, that's 7 years. At the worst, we have a 7 year. I mean, I never thought I'd have it. I'm going to be 62 years old in July. Come on. I mean, I'm a happy man. I should be content, right? And for all intent and purpose, I am. I couldn't be. Nobody could be more thrilled. Boy, if I could ask, if anybody could have a life like mine and have gone through what I went through and have this success, I'd say that's the way to do it. So much better than having it young, because I appreciate it so much more. But you still have that, you know, they're going to jerk the rug out from under me at any minute, and it's going to be over, and oh, my God, and I can't stop myself.
By the way, I don't even have to call tomorrow morning for the ratings on this. I know. It's about a 1.5.
Is that good?
Yeah, it's about equal. 20 of these is about one coach. But remember, 1.5 will win the time slot because we're up against the Ginsu Knife Showcase, and that's Amore. So you won again. You were number one in this time slot.
Oh, boy, I had a break.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Boy, your career is really on a roll. See you later.